pretty good stuff, young lady.
Let's go. Welcome to First Baptist Church. We're so glad to see y'all in the house of the Lord this morning. Let's all stand up.
that stone was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death, and the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe, for the souls of all who come to the Father are restored.
And the church of Christ was born, and is living in the grave. Now the gospel to the world shall not kneel, shall not bend. By His blood and in His name, in His freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me.
Aren't you glad for His resurrection this morning? Aren't you glad? Let's take praise!
Praise the Father!
Praise the
Son! Praise the Spirit! Praise the Father! God of glory, majesty! Praise the heavens to the
sing it again!
Man, what a great song. Amen. I mean, praise forever to the King of Kings. I mean, He's the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. He's our God. He's our Savior. And I hope you are excited about being here and worshiping our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ this morning, especially after that song. Man, what a great song. Good morning, guests. Thank you for worshiping with us today at First Baptist Church. It's so good to have you guys with us this morning. Brother Doug sends his welcome and his thank you for coming this morning, because he's on vacation. He is out of town this week, and he says thanks for coming this morning and to tell everyone that he says hey. So hey from Brother Doug. For our scriptural spotlight this morning comes from Johnny Frank, and it is Philippians 2:3. It says, do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility consider others better than yourselves. Here's what Johnny says about this particular verse that he finds so helpful in his life. He says, Paul is telling us how to follow Jesus' example of humility. If all believers could adopt this mindset, there would be very little strife and division within the body of Christ, and we would be the true light of the world. And this is so true this morning. Again, meditate on that verse, Philippians 2:3. You may want to commit that to memory this week. It's just a great verse to help us to remember, like, put others first. And we want you to do that as well. Mr. Lester is going to be praying for us this morning. Mr. Lester, lead us in prayer.
Let us pray. Dear Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for your word. Father, thank you for this last Sunday of July. Thank you for the time away. Thank you for these children and students, the time they have had in camps. Thank you for the success of those camps, the reports that have been brought from that. Thank you for bringing our children home yesterday after their summer camp as well. Father, we lift up those in our church who have just recently lost loved ones. Lord, we pray that you would comfort them, bring grace to their families. Father, we also pray for those who are healing from a recent procedure. Thank you for the medical teams that have worked with them. Father, we pray that your grace and glory would be with them as well. Father, we pray for travel mercies for others who are traveling, our pastor and different ones and from our family and church family, Lord, as they squeeze that last bit of summer out. Father, we lift up the students as they're about to start another school year. Keep them safe and help them in their learning time. Father, we thank you for bringing our last staff member or the newest staff member to fill the hole in our student section for student director. Thank you for Connor and helping him answer the call for you. Thank you for expanding Matt's territory and giving him the health and strength to have such a successful time as leading this student ministry, and how he and Connor will truly bring that to a higher level. Bless us now with the rest of this service. All these things we ask in your name. Amen.
You ought to stand. Chuck's going to lead us in this wonderful hymn of our faith. All the way my Savior leads me. Let's sing it out.
All the way, my Savior.
You may be seated. Father, we're so grateful to be in your house. You're everything that you've ever promised you would be. Help us to be men and women of our word to you. It's by your mercies, your grace, that we're not consumed. Every morning we have brand new mercies. Great is your faithfulness to us. I thank you for everyone here under the sound of my voice. Bless who's in attendance. Bless their extended families. We bless those who listen to us online. You're giving us a digital footprint that is changing the lives of people. We thank you for it, the testimonies that are coming in. It's not anything to do with us, but it's by your grace. And we're thankful for that. Bless those who are close to us, who are hurting. We just ask that you be able to give us a word of comfort or just presence or just prayer. I ask that you would anoint Brother Matt as he preaches your word. Give him freedom in the spirit to hear from you and to convey to us what the Spirit is saying to the church. We thank you for that. Bless your people today. We love you so much, and we thank you for loving us first. And God, we're thankful that you're able to do exceeding and abundantly above all we can ask or think according to the power that you've given us. You're more than able, more than amazing, more than wonderful. And we thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Miracles, 'cause you are more than able. You are more than able. You are more than able. Yes, you are. We see it.
You are more than able.
Darkness. Darkness. No one likes being in the dark. But yet, at times, we like being in the dark. When I was little and growing up, I lived on a hill overlooking the Delta, and I would love watching the thunderstorms roll up coming across the Delta. The sky would turn so dark blue and black as they would roll in. And then when the storms would come in, a lot of times they would knock the power out. And man, as a little kid, I'd go find all kinds of stuff, go get my flashlights. I would go get maybe a book or two that I could read with my flashlight. And yes, I had a battery-operated black and white TV with a screen of about that big. And I remember I would try to make a little tent, or I would make something in which I could, like, oh, the lights are all dark, and I could get in there and I'd watch this little battery-operated TV in the dark. And in times we'd like being in the dark in those instances. But then, as I got older, and then I had to live by myself, found out I didn't like the dark so much. And then comes along Melanie, and I said, hey, do you want to get married? I don't like being here by myself in the dark. And she said, sure. And I was like, yes. And so a lot of times we think, okay, we like the darkness, we don't like the darkness, it can be scary, it's not scary. While most of us really do try to avoid physical darkness at all costs, the Bible says we can avoid spiritual darkness with the help of Jesus. And that's what we're going to be looking at this morning. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to 1 John. 1 John. And we're still in the first chapter there of 1 John. In a previous message we looked at, we talked about or answered the question, what is Christianity? And we talked about how John is an eyewitness of Jesus and how he uses the words there in the opening chapter, things that he's seen, things that he knows about Jesus, the things that he's touched with his hands, using all these physical words to describe his relationship with Jesus. John is trying to combat some heresies as well that's going on. Some people are thinking that you can be basically good, but you can do whatever you want to do. You can be good, but your actions don't really matter. You can believe in God, but you can basically do whatever you want to do. And so John is writing, no, that is not the case. And so John wants to look at this question, who is God? Who is God? We looked at what is Christianity. Now we're looking at who is God. And so by asking this question, John's going to help us to see this morning that God is light, and in him there is no darkness. If you're taking notes this morning, that's what I want you to see as the main point, that God is light, and in him there is no darkness. John describes two different groups: those who are a part of God's covenant and those who are not a part of God's covenant this morning. When you read John's gospel, when you read 1 John, you see that he talks about two different things, light and darkness. And so we're going to look this morning in this passage, beginning in verse 5, and we're going to see, number one, the holiness of God. The holiness of God. Look in verse 5. This is the message we have heard from him and proclaim to you, that God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. So we're going to stop right there. Here in verse 5, John teaches us about the true nature of God. Again, that's his point. He's trying to combat some of these heresies. He's trying to combat some of these false teachings about God. And he wants the people to know immediately, first off, God is light. He is light, and there is no darkness in him at all. And so out of all of the apostles, John gives us really the best picture of the true nature of God. If we read in the Gospels, if we read in 1 John, John really gives us a great picture of who God really is. John describes God as being spirit in his Gospel, chapter 4, verse 24. He describes God as light in 1 John 1, 5, and he describes God as love in chapter 4, verse 8. And all of these characteristics really are, give us a broad picture, a comprehensive definition of God that we have. And so this is who God is, this God of light, in whom there's no darkness. And so we really see two things in verse 5. The first thing is we see God's message. God's message, he says, this is the message, right? And he's, oh, John, what message? Whose message? It's God's message. The word is angelia. It's where we get the word angel, messenger, message. It means to proclaim. It's a proclamation that he's giving here about the message of who God is. And it's from him, meaning God. So we see this message, and not only do we see God's message, but we see God's morality in verse 5. Because John contrasts the light with the darkness. And the concept of light and darkness is really universal. You can read a lot of different writings and all across the world in which they talk about light and darkness. But in universal language, light really is associated with truth and purity, whereas darkness is associated with error and evil. And he uses the word light here. And what is John saying? God is light. Is he physical light? Well, yeah, I think so. I think part of it is he's physical light. I love reading at the end in Revelation where it talks about there's not going to be a sun. When God creates the new heavens and the new earth, there's not going to be a sun because the light of Jesus Christ is going to emanate, and there's no need for a sun. So there's some physical light as well. But not only physical light, but John here is also referring to the ethical and moral nature of God. He's saying that the light and darkness don't go together. Light doesn't go with dark. Dark does not go with light. And so the false teachers claimed that they had truly been enlightened. They were kind of had this idea like, I'm in the know. I'm better than you. What I know about God is true, and I can basically do whatever I want to because I know what's true about God, and the rules basically don't apply to me. And that's simply not the case. That's simply not the case then, and it's simply not the case now. What about darkness? It refers to evil. First to not being pure. So God hates evil. God hates an evil conscience, wickedness, basically anything that has to do with darkness. And so here's the bottom line here in verse 5, is that John wants you to know this, that if Christians are truly want to enjoy Christ and enjoy the blessings of Christ, and then what we need to do is place our faith in God, in which there is no darkness. That's basically what John is trying to set up in this section of scripture this morning. So this is the holiness of God. But the next thing we see is the sinfulness of man. The sinfulness of man. And so in this next section, we're going to see some conditional statements. If then, a conditional statement has the word if in it. If you do this, then this. And so there's three denials here in this next section. That if you do this, if you deny this, then it shows that you are this or never really this in the first place. So let's look at these denials. The first one, let's look in verse 6. 6 through 7 says, if we claim that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with the one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses us from all sin. So here's the first claim. The first claim is that a person says that they have fellowship with God, but yet in their life they're characterized by an unholy life. And John says this simply can't be the case. Simply can't be true. And so the apostle, again, contrasts the nature of both light and darkness. John describes for us a person who walks in darkness. And what about the word walk? Well, you've heard me say this. You've heard Brother Doug say this. Walk really means the way of life. And that's what John is using here. That's what he wants you to know. It's not just like you messed up one time and you're repentant and sorry. It's not what he's saying. He's saying, like, this is your walk. This is something that is ongoing in your life. This is an habitual characteristic that is something that's going on in your life. And that's the way the Jews understood this word. That's how it's used also in the Old Testament. And so to walk in darkness means to really live a life of sin without the illumination, without the guidance of God in your life. We use light all the time to help us in the dark. We mentioned that before. I like to have a flashlight with me if I was a kid and reading a book. But the lights help us. They help us to see. They help when we're filming to illuminate everything clearly. When you are on stage and you're acting, everything is dark. And if you didn't have a light on stage, some of you that have done this before, you could just fall right off into the audience. You need some kind of illumination around you to help you see to where to go so you will not stumble in the darkness. So John also describes for us a person who's walking in the light. So he says, this is a person walking in the darkness. Now here's someone who's walking in the light in verse 7. It says, cleanses us. The word cleanse, right, has the idea of being purified, to become holy. And believers can know with certainty that God accepts them because they have been united with God through their Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And when you have that relationship, the blood of Jesus cleanses you from all sin. And that's why we get so excited singing these songs this morning. Yeah, they sound good. Yeah, they may be a particular genre that you like. But ultimately, we're not just singing because we like the preference of the music. We're singing because we like the words in which we're proclaiming to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And man, when you can get a good tune that matches some good lyrics, whoa, that's a recipe for a great song. But that's why we're here today, to proclaim that we are Christians and that we love God, that we love Jesus, and that Jesus cleanses us. And we're so thankful for what God and what Jesus Christ has done in our life. But there's a second denial. Look in verses 8 through 9. Here it is again. If we claim that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from unrighteousness. So here we are again saying, if. Note there's a claim there, right? If we are without sin, there's the denial, there's the claim, saying that we are without sin. And that's what John is trying to combat. He's like, guys, if you're saying this, then it's proof that you are walking in darkness, that you're not a part of the light. And then notice there's the confession that's there in verse 8. It says, the word for confess is the idea of saying the same thing as. So when we confess, it's not just saying, God, that what I did was wrong, but you're saying, God, I agree with you that what I did was wrong. God, we agree with you that what we did was not right. That's the idea behind confession, meaning to be in agreement with. So God is cleansing us from all unrighteousness. And I love how he uses the words faithful and just. Faithful and just. Just meaning that God is always going to do what is right. You never have to worry that if God is going to do anything wrong or if God's going to act out of step or act out of character or act in a willy-nilly kind of way. John's saying God's not going to do that. He is just. He's perfect to cleanse us from all unrighteousness, and he's faithful. Faithful. When you read Scripture, if you start from Genesis and you start reading the Bible, the idea of God's faithfulness is going to show up over and over again. One, you're going to see it in what he does in the life of the Israelites, especially if they're in Egypt and they're coming back. And Brother Doug has had some sermons on this that we've listened to about God and how he's faithful to the people. And then what they do in response to God's faithfulness is sing. They sing and proclaim God's faithfulness. When the Israelites come out into the land of Canaan from Egypt, and Pharaoh's army is overthrown, there's a song about God's faithfulness. We see a lot of songs throughout. Psalms is a great book to look through. All these psalms about how God has intervened and interacted in the life of David because God is faithful. But then there's a third denial. Verse 10 says, if we claim that we have not sinned, then we make him, talking about God, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. So this basically is a claim that you're perfect. This is a claim that you've never sinned. But this is not the case according to the Bible, right? I mean, one of the first verses that we maybe have learned, or maybe you learned as a little kid, is Romans 3:23, right? For some have sinned. That's not right. For a few people, all have sinned, right? For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. So all have sinned, meaning it's universal. No one is exempt from that. You're not exempt. I'm not exempt. No one is perfect. And so for all have sinned. John says in verse 10 that if we say we haven't sinned, then we make him to be a liar, and his word is not in us. And boy, that's a dangerous thing, isn't it? To call God a liar. Whew. Brothers and sisters, please let that never be said of us, where we have been put in that situation to where we've been tempted to call God a liar. It's just simply not true. The Lord is faithful. The Lord is just. It is not God who has wandered away from us in our situations, but it's us who've wandered away from the Lord. And so we don't want to be caught in such a serious sin of trying to say that God is a liar. But here's some good news. Look in chapter 2. This is verses 1 and 2. Here's some of the best news for you and for us. This is the atoning work of Jesus that takes place. Look in verse 1. My dear children, I write this to you that you will not sin. But, he says, but if anybody does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. He is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not only ours, but for the sins of the whole world. Man, that is the good news. It's part of the gospel message that Jesus Christ came to save sinners, in which you and I are sinners. That means Jesus Christ came to save us from our sins. He uses two ideas here. One is an advocate. It's an advocate. Jesus Christ is on your side. He's an advocate for you. It's kind of a court, it's a court term, really, is what it is. It's saying that Jesus Christ is kind of like your defense attorney. You're going up before Satan wants to accuse you. Satan means accuser. So he's going before God. He's trying to accuse you before God. And then you have a great defense attorney, Jesus, who is your advocate for you. And so Christ comes, and he takes the place there. And he's not only your advocate, but he's an atoning sacrifice. He's an atoning sacrifice. And I love in the translation I use that they use the phrase atoning sacrifice. Your translation may have expiation, may have a big word, propitiation. But I really like atoning sacrifice. One, it's just easier to say. And it has the idea of both of those words combined. Now, what does that even mean? I mean, those are some big words. Well, the word propitiation just simply means that Jesus Christ placated an angry God who was mad, not because just he wanted to be angry, but because of the sin that is in our life. And what we should have done, or what was our punishment, was to go on the cross. Jesus did that. He was the punishment. He was the sacrifice to do that for us. And not only was he the propitiation, but he was the expiation. And that just simply means that in the Old Testament, they would do the sacrifices. They would come and they would kill the animal. They would sprinkle the blood on the altar, and that would show a sign of a sacrifice had to take place for the cleansing of sin. And then they would pray the sins over an animal, a goat, and they would send that goat out into the wilderness. That was the scapegoat, and that was sending the sins away from the people. And that's also associated with this word. So Christ did all of that for you and for me. And that, to me, is, again, a reason why I'm here today worshiping with my brothers and sisters in Christ, proclaiming the good news of salvation because of what God has done for us in His Son, Jesus. There's nothing greater to me, though, than worshiping and hearing the voices of the saints. I love hearing people sing. I love hearing when Derek says, just our voices. I love hearing all of us as one sing the songs that we have to God. I'm gonna look at the screens. I'm gonna show a picture up on the screen this morning. There's a thing that we do at church camp called campfire. And I've had a lot of people ask, Brother Matt, what is campfire? Is it where we go beside a camp or a fire? And I'm like, no, there's no fire that is involved. And it's inside, so there's really no fire if it's inside at all. But we join around this light bulb. And we see some prompts on the screen. You can see there on the screen, there's some prompts there. And it's usually a question that they've asked the students throughout the week. And so you're reading these questions. You're reading the answers to these questions. And then you're hearing the voices of not just adults, but these are students proclaiming the goodness of God. I mean, let me tell you. I don't care how manly you are, if you're sitting there and it does not somehow bring tears to your eyes to hear all those kids singing to Jesus, I'm telling you, it is a sweet, sweet, sweet time. Not only were we at camp and we were able to experience this, but one of the days of camp, the second week of camp, a storm rolled through and knocked out all the power. So we didn't have any power. We didn't have any lights. We didn't have any electric guitars, any drums. How can you worship with no electric guitars? But they had a guy who came up, an acoustic, and we had our voices. And I love what the pastor said. You do not have to have electricity to have power. And I thought, man, you don't have to have electricity to experience the power of God.
Yes, sir.
He was still working. God was still saving students, even with no power. And it's amazing, again, it's just amazing what that week can do for your soul, in which you can go a week, get rid of all the distractions in your life. You can be outside in the day and experience the light. You can be with each other in the dark and singing these songs. And it's just a time of sweet, sweet fellowship. But what does that have to do with you? Three things really quickly and we'll close. Number one, God is light. You've got to remember that this morning. If you leave here today and don't remember anything, just remember the one thing, that God is the light. God is going to help you. God is going to help us grow in our relationship with Him. And we just simply have to acknowledge our sin. We just simply have to admit that we are sinners. And God says right there in 1 John, God will cleanse us from that sin. Number two, genuine believers will be growing in their relationship with God. Genuine believers will be growing in their relationship with God. And this is a little bit more tricky. We live in a fast-paced society. We live in a culture that wants instantaneous results. We don't always want to work hard at what we do. We just kind of want to look at a book and absorb what is in the book without having to read the book. But take time to grow in your relationship by praying to the Lord. Set time each day to pray. Set a time to read your Bible. Set a time to make sure that you try to be here on Wednesdays and on Sundays. Be involved in a life group with people that you can come, that you can live life with. Find a person and read a book, a good Christian book with them. Maybe meet with some people in the morning for coffee, or meet someone for lunch throughout the week and just be involved in their life and just say, how are you doing? And then third, praise and thank God for sending His Son Jesus to save us from our sins. Praise God for that. And again, that's what we're doing. That's what we do by coming to church and sitting under the preaching and teaching of the Lord and joining each other in that fellowship and coming together so we can praise this God that we serve for sending His Son. There have been many great men throughout history. Many men who have done wonderful, awesome things that have been written about in history books. And none other of those great men is Chuck Norris. Yes, you heard that correctly. Chuck Norris, when he slices onions, the onions cry. When the boogeyman goes to sleep at night, he checks his closet for Chuck Norris. Chuck Norris once got bitten by a poisonous snake, and after three agonizing days, the snake finally died. Now, I love a good Chuck Norris joke, and they really do emphasize a guy that I used to watch so much growing up. I watched a lot of his movies, watched Walker, Texas Ranger. I mean, this was my man. This is the guy I watched all the time. Loved all of his movies, loved the karate. This is a man right here. But he's just a man. He is just a man. He is not perfect. He is not sinless. But Jesus is. Jesus is. There's someone greater than Chuck Norris, and that's Jesus Christ. God sent his one and only Son to this world to be sin for you and for me. He's the God of light. In him there's no darkness. And John says this morning, if you would just simply place your faith and trust in him, confess those sins and place your faith and trust in him, you will have eternal life. Let's pray. God, I thank you so much for your Son, Jesus. I thank you, Father, for sending him into this world. As it says in John's gospel, not to condemn the world, but to give us life. To be a light shining in a dark, dark place. I pray that if there's someone in here this morning that doesn't know you, that if someone in here today does not have a relationship with you, that you would save them and that they would call out upon your name. I pray that they would have boldness and courage to do that today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's all stand. Need prayer this morning? Want to join our church or come for salvation? The altar is open. Let's all stand together.
Again, thank you so much for worshiping with us today. I'll be down in the front as you leave this morning. If you'd like to make First Baptist your church home or just have any questions about who Jesus is, I'd love to answer those. Again, don't forget the offering as you leave this morning. And we're about to start August, and it'll be a good time. Hey, join a life group. Join a life group. We have those at 9 a.m. every Sunday, followed by our morning worship in here at 10 a.m. And then we also have our promotion for our children and students. So they're going to be moving up. If you've got a kid that has graduated and moving into the seventh grade, and if you've got a kid that's promoting into a different grade, this is when we're going to do it. It's going to be Sunday, August the 4th, and then the Wednesday following on August the 7th. And then, as Derek mentioned earlier, tomorrow we're going to have funeral services for Matt Mason here. It's going to be 10 a.m. to 12 with a funeral following that. Our piano player, Miss Judy Mason's her son. So be in prayer for that family, precious, precious family, and the loss of Matt Mason. So, there.
All our visitors who have come to be with us today, we love you so much, and you're welcome to come anytime. Let's all stand. We're going to sing Make Us One.